भगवते वासुदेवाय नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयं उदीरये नष्टप्रायेषु भद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवत्युत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः स उत्तम श्लोक महन्मुखच्युतो भवत्पदां भोज सुधा कणानिलः स्मृतिं पुनर्विस्मृत तत्ववर्त्मनां कुयोगिनाम्नो वितरत्यलंबरैः स उत्तम श्लोक महन्मुखच्युतो भवत्पदां भोज सुधा कणानिलः स्मृतिं पुनर्विस्मृत तत्ववर्त्मनां कुयोगिनाम्नो वितरत्यलंबरैः स उत्तम श्लोक महन्मुखच्युतो भवत्पदाम्भोज सुधा कणानिलः स्मृतिं पुनर्विस्मृत तत्ववर्त्मनां कुयोगिनाम्नो विदरत्यलम्बरैः स उत्तम श्लोक महन्मुखच्युतो भवत्पदां भोज सुधा कणानिलः स्मृतिं पुनर्विस्मृत तत्ववर्त्मनां कुयोगिनां नो वितरत्यलम्बरैः स उत्तम श्लोक महन्मुखच्युतो भवत्पदाम्भोजसुधा कणानिलः स्मृतिं पुनर्विस्मृत तत्ववर्त्मनां कुयोगिनां नो वितरत्यलम्बरैः स उत्तम श्लोक महन्मुखच्युतो भवत्पदाम्भोजसुधा कणानिलः स्मृतिं पुनर्विस्मृत तत्ववर्त्मनां कुयोगिनां माताजी स उत्तम श्लोक महन्मुखच्युतो भवत्पदाम्भोज सुधा कणानिलः स्मृतिं पुनर्विस्मृत तत्ववर्त्मनां कुयोगिनां नो वितरत्यलम्बरैः सह दैट उत्तम श्लोक ओ लॉर्ड हु आर प्रेज्ड बाय सेलेक्टेड वर्सेस महत ऑफ ग्रेट डिवोटीज मुखच्युतः डेलिवर्ड फ्रॉम द माउथ्स भवत युअर बद अम्भोज फ्रॉम द लोटस फीट सुधा ऑफ नेक्टर कण पार्टिकल्स अनिलह सूदिंग ब्रीज स्मृतिम रिमेम्बरेंस पुनः अगेन विस्मृत फॉरगॉटन तत्व टू द ट्रूथ वर्तमानम ऑफ पर्सन्स हूज पास कुयोगिनाम ऑफ पर्सन्स नॉट इन द लाइन ऑफ डिवोशनल सर्विस नह of us, vitarati, restores, alam, unnecessary. Varaihi, other benedictions. Translation purport by His Divine Grace, S.A. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Sri Prabhupada ki. My dear Lord, you are glorified by the selected verses uttered by great personalities. Such glorification of your lotus feet is just like saffron particles. When the transcendental vibration from the mouths of great devotees carries the aroma of the saffron dust of your lotus feet, the forgetful living entity gradually remembers his eternal relationship with you. Devotees thus gradually come to the right conclusion about the value of life. My dear Lord, I therefore do not need any other benediction but the opportunity to hear from the mouth of your pure devotee. Like that Prithu Maharaj is telling Lord Vishnu. Purport. It is explained in the previous verse that one has to hear glorification of the Lord from the mouth of a pure devotee. This is further explained here. The transcendental vibration from the mouth of a pure devotee is so powerful that it can revive the living entity's memory of his eternal relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In our material existence, under the influence of the illusory Maya, we have almost forgotten our eternal relationship with the Lord, exactly like a man sleeping very deeply who forgets his duties. In the Vedas, it is said that every one of us is sleeping under the influence of Maya. We must get up from this slumber and engage in the right service, for thus we can properly utilize the facility of this human form of life. As expressed in a song by Thakur Bhaktivinod, Lord Chaitanya says, Jiva Jaga, Jiva Jaga. And Lord asks every sleeping living entity to get up and engage in devotional service, so that his mission in this human form of life may be fulfilled. This awakening voice comes through the mouth of a pure devotee. A pure devotee always engages in the service of the Lord, taking shelter of his lotus feet, and therefore he has a direct connection with the saffron mercy particles that are strewn over the lotus feet of the Lord. Although when a pure devotee speaks, the articulation of his voice may resemble the sound of this material sky, and the voice is spiritually very powerful because it touches the particles of saffron dust on the lotus feet of the Lord. As soon as a sleeping living entity hears the powerful voice emanating from the mouth of a pure devotee, he immediately remembers his eternal relationship with the Lord. Although up until that moment, he had forgotten everything. For a conditioned soul, therefore, it is very important to hear from the mouth of a pure devotee who is fully surrendered to the lotus feet of the Lord without any material desire, speculative knowledge or contamination of the modes of material nature. Every one of us is kuyogi because we have engaged in the service of this material world, forgetting our eternal relationship with the Lord as His eternal loving servants. It is our duty to rise from the kuyoga platform to become suyogis, perfect mystics. The process of hearing from a pure devotee is recommended in all Vedic literatures, Vedic scriptures, especially by Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. One may stay in his position of life. It does not matter what it is, but if one hears from the mouth of a pure devotee, he gradually comes to the understanding of his relationship with the Lord and thus engages in his loving service, and his life becomes completely perfect. Therefore, this process of hearing from the mouth of a pure devotee is very important for making progress in the line of spiritual understanding. So, one point is very powerfully standing out in this purport, which is repeated by Prabhupada 3 to 4 times in the purport for emphasis, and so that we may not forget. Why actually he's talking about forgetfulness and we should come to remembrance, but while reading purport also we forget what we heard in the purport. Therefore he says the same point at least 4 times in this purport. What is that point? Anybody recollects? Hearing from a pure devotee, that point is repeatedly emphasized. Yeah, correct. Pure devotee, yeah, then one can recollect that, yes. So one observation you will make, those devotees who hear Srila Prabhupada's lectures regularly, they will be very spirited and very fired up. You will see that. You check it anywhere in the world. The reason for this is Prabhupada's lectures are very plain, simple, straightforward, up to the point, and very strongly instructing to give up Maya and take shelter of Krishna. And also, there is a very strong sense of emergency in Prabhupada's lectures. If you have seen, Srila Prabhupada as Abhay Charan when he went to meet Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, at the time, what hit him very hard was this point. He had asked him the question, you are asking me to preach in the West in English language, but who will take the message of India seriously? Because right now India is under foreign subjugation. First let's get freedom and then we can do the needful. But Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur refused. I mean, he denied that point. He said, Krishna consciousness is the emergency. It cannot wait for anything. And long before, you know, Mughals were ruling India, then they left the country and then British came. Now British will go and then Japanese were trying. And then later on Chinese were trying to occupy India. He said one party will rule, they will go, another party will come, but these are all secondary things. What is most important is Krishna consciousness, which is emergency, because it is not on the material platform. Krishna consciousness is the language of the soul. So all of us are souls and our situation is eternal. Lord is eternal, we are eternal and the love is eternal. So he spoke from the heart and he said, you see, in our country there are many doctorates and post-doctorates, but even after acquiring such a big position, these doctorates and post-doctorates are all preparing bombs to throw in the neighborhood country. And the neighborhood country is preparing another set of doctorates to throw bomb in this country. So he said the highest or the topmost education on the material platform still makes a man an animal, you know, killing one another, fighting with one another, based on racism, casteism, based on caste, creed, color, nationality, gender and all these things. But he said Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's movement is such a movement, na bhuto na bhavishyati. There is no movement like this where harmless species are produced. A Vaishnava is called as the most harmless species. He cannot even harm an ant also. Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur told him that there has never been in the past or there will never be in future any followers like the quality of Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's followers, he said. Because he said, look at the Vaishnava's caliber and character and quality and lifestyle and behavior and speech. Actually, Vaishnava is one who sees all living entities as Krishna's children. And he sees all the material paraphernalia as Lord's energy. Therefore, he will never exploit the other living beings and he will never misuse the material paraphernalia. He will use everyone and everything in Krishna's service. And he knows, I myself belong to Krishna. I am myself a part and parcel of Krishna. So therefore, he said preaching this Krishna consciousness is the most important thing and reviving the Krishna consciousness is the most important thing. So the way Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur preached in Ultradanga, that matha now, even today ISKCON has purchased that matha now. Very soon you will find a beautiful, one of my dear friends in Calcutta, Anangamohan Prabhu is going to take part in the fundraising and constructing it. So they are going to make a Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur speaking to Prabhupada Murthy they will make, and also all the library of Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur's books, many things they will do there. But the point is this, that one meeting was a turning point meeting. For whom? For Srila Prabhupada. After that Prabhupada, wherever he went, he said, Krishna consciousness emergency, Krishna consciousness emergency. So how he spoke, because the impact of the talk of a pure devotee, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, had a powerful influence on him. Similarly, when Prabhupada preaches very purely, so there has to be some conditions met for us to be impacted by someone's message. See, if a seashell is open and a swati rain falls in it, a particular type of rain they say has to fall in it, and then it closes, then it goes into the ocean and goes round and round and round for a long time And then after many years, when it comes out and opens, what do you find inside?
Pearl
you find. So the words emanating from the lips of a pure devotee are like the Swati rain. And the Sipi is like our heart. First of all, a disciple or a devotee should have open mind and attentive ear. When you have attentive ear and open mind to hear the message without any kinds of screening, without any kinds of reservations. Sometimes we think, what does he know? I know better. Like that. Or sometimes we think, you know, maybe he's not very advanced. We have our own ideas of people even who found fault with Prabhupada couldn't benefit from Prabhupada. But those who did not find fault, they could, you know, hear it transparently. So our attentive ear and open mind, and then the spiritual message is placed by the devotee, and then you take that message and you contemplate on the message and you live that message, and the result is you get pearl-like realizations from that. And then such a person who's realized, for him this message becomes so important, all important. He breathes the message, he worships the message, he lives the message, he preaches the message to others, he delights in the message, and he becomes one with the message. He makes the message an integral part of his own existence. And then that very same message takes him back home, back to Godhead. Prabhupada said the spiritual master lives in his sound vibration and the follower lives with him, he said. So, therefore, one has to take the message very seriously. And when one loves the pure devotee, then that message, when it is coming down, one will be able to open the mind and heart. Then one can take it. If there is no affection, there is no respect, then one won't be able to take the message. One's mind is closed. You all will see, when we came in our early days, our mind and heart was very open, and we were very innocent, and we were very simple, and we considered everybody a pure devotee. Do you agree? Correct? The very early days. Everybody, whoever wore tilak and kantimala and bead bag, they had, we thought they are pure devotees. But eventually, we could start seeing faults in different devotees, and therefore our mind and heart gets very closed and we are not able to receive the message. Now, when mind and heart are open, then the message which is going in, that has to be a pure message. It is not enough for you to have an open mind and heart, but the message is an impure message. Nowadays, on this planet, we find there are many, many preachers. I'm not only talking about ISKCON, outside ISKCON also, many other spiritual organizations. They don't present spirituality purely about Atma, Paramatma, and Sambandha between the two. That is not the main talk. There is so much talk about health. There is so much talk about entertainment. There is so much talk about mind, stress. There is talk about relationships. Now human beings are struggling to survive as human beings. So therefore, all over the world you find, now even the people who are monks, you will find that there is a tendency to, you know, gravitate towards those subjects which are giving pleasure to the living entities. There is a tendency to speak those subjects because people easily accept you. And you speak the straight truth, then people say he is outlandish. You know, he is not able to keep abreast of the times and the need of the hour. You know, people think like that. So, in order to be a popular person, and in order to flow with the wind, you speak. But the problem is, the soul will not wake up. The soul will be sleeping peacefully. It is exactly like sometimes imagine you are sleeping in the bed. Somebody is singing lullaby for you. La 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 la. They are doing. That lullaby puts the child to more sleep. In a winter season, you are covering with the blanket. Somebody comes and sings lullaby for you. And what will you do? You will sleep longer. So, any lecture, any message that does not speak the truth is nothing but a lullaby for the illusioned soul. Making the soul kindly sleep more. You pamper the mind, pamper the false ego. You give some motivation to the sleeping soul and say that, hey, sleeping soul, sleep more, don't worry, everything is all right with you. Everything is go on with your life. You will be successful, you will be a winner. You will be winner, you will be this, you will be that. Simply cheating. It has no substance. So therefore, Prabhupada's message should be captured as he speaks, should be internalized, should be assimilated, relished, and digested and realized, and it should be spoken again. Otherwise, how will the parampara nicely continue? So many Prabhupada's disciples, you will see, they are very faithful and honest to Srila Prabhupada. They speak exactly the way Prabhupada has presented. You will see in the Guru Parampara, the acharyas, many of them speak from Prabhupada's books and pastimes and everything. But down the line, as the ages pass, there's my purity and the content, the purity of the message has to be kept. Only then it will wake up the sleeping soul. The message is loud and clear, that the living entity has come to this world to make a separate program of enjoyment. And he is wandering in this world like a ghost-haunted person. A ghost-haunted person speaks any nonsense. Similarly, the living entity imagines himself to be a great person. And Prabhupada gives a couple of examples I heard in one of his lectures for forgetfulness. He says, sometimes a thief steals and is caught by the police. And he is beaten with the belt. Not that he has not got such beating before. Earlier also he stole. He was beaten also. And then he was put in the behind the bars. He came out. Again he is stealing. Why? Because he became forgetful. So forgetfulness is the greatest curse of a conditioned soul. The Nitya Siddhas have no forgetfulness. They cannot forget the Lord even for a moment. Continuous remembrance they have. 24/7 throughout their life. At any point of time, you will see Srila Prabhupada, when they were applying massage, one devotee was massaging Prabhupada's body with oil. So even while taking massage, he was a new devotee was massaging. So he wrote in one of the Leelas of Prabhupada, he said, even while massaging, Prabhupada asked him, so are you preaching? He asked him. He said, yes, Prabhupada, what do you preach? He asked. So then he spoke, Prabhupada, tell the people you should go back home, back to Godhead. The goal of life is to go beyond this, the Dukkalayam and Ashashvatam. So, and Prabhupada said, all that is all right, but first you should tell them you are not the body, you are the soul. And then you tell other things. So he was telling, even while taking care of the body, Prabhupada was very conscious of the soul. Now there is a lot of talk about taking care of the body, but while taking care of the body, we forget the soul. We become more bodily conscious. Then what's the use? Prabhupada, even while taking care of the body, Prabhupada was going for morning walk, but in morning walk, what he did? That is all recorded. When we go for a morning walk, can we record anything? Only the sound of the shoes we can record. But what did Prabhupada do while morning walk? He was always glorifying Krishna, the message. When he was taking an oil massage in the body, he was always talking about Krishna. There was not a moment he wasted. And if we become too bodily conscious, then we become forgetful of Krishna. We become, the forgetfulness is the curse of a conditioned soul, I was telling you. So the thief forgets that he got punishment before, then again he gets good beating and he is put behind the bars. After some time again he steals, again he is putting. Therefore, Parikshit Maharaj asks this question. Drishta shrutabhyam yat papam janannapi atmano ahitam karoti bhuyo vivashah prayaschittamato katham. He said, oh Shukadeva Goswamiji, tell me, my dear Guru, how is it drishta means seen, shruta means heard. We have seen in this world thieves are beaten up and put behind the bars. And we have heard from the Shastra that sinners are sent to hell. Even after having seen and heard all these things, why a person keeps on doing the same blunders in this world over and over again? So there are many answers he gave, but the final answer I will tell you. He said actually devotional service epitomized by the chanting of the holy name and hearing of the Srimad Bhagavatam. This is the solution to destroy forgetfulness. That's what he told. Ultimately. Kechit kevalaya bhaktiya vasudeva parayanaha. Agham dunvanti karchniyena. Niharimiva bhaskara. Just like the sun in the morning rising in the sky evaporates dissolves the fog. Like that our ignorance is compared to fog. And the fog is dissolved by the sun. Similarly, Krishna is like the sun, Krishna Suri Sama. How he arises in our heart? He said, by hearing. There are two types of hearing. One is hearing the chanting and hearing the katha. So, nama smaranam, bhagavat shravanam. These two things are the panacea. Panacea means sarvaroga nivarani. They can completely destroy all the diseases of the conditioned soul, including his forgetfulness. Kama, krodha, lobha, all these things will be finished if one hears. And therefore, I took this particular verse. Hears means what? What does he hear? From whom does he hear? One should hear pure message from a pure devotee. You can read 1837, I think, Bhagavatam. 1836, 37, 38. In that one of those verses, mostly 37 or 38, I think. This is Kunti Maharani's prayers. There, 1837, 38. In that Prabhupada says, in this world it is seen that people like Kamsa or Duryodhana, Dushasana, Shakuni, they all have seen Krishna with eye to eye. But they did not feel love for Krishna because they were envious of Krishna. Now, and then Prabhupada writes, then what is the use of seeing Krishna with eye? Seeing Krishna is only useful if you can see him with love, with Premanjana Charita. If I cannot see Krishna with eyes of love, then we will be counted amongst those fellows only, isn't it? Then you may have a question, how can I see Krishna with eyes of love? So in order for us to be able to see Krishna with eyes of love, one should hear the Nama Rupa Gunalila, like that he says. Okay, now to hear the Nama Rupa Gunalila of the Lord, there are many people speaking. In television, you get in YouTube, so many people are speaking about Nama Rupa Gunalila. There are so many Bhagavad Saptahas going on. Prabhupada says, even after hearing it all, still one does not feel any attraction for Krishna. Why? Because they are materially motivated. They are money makers. Many of them, they pamper the audience. They speak for the manoranjan of the audience, entertainment. So ultimately, at the end of the day, they put money in their pocket and go. There is no intention of purifying the heart of the audience, transforming the heart of the audience. And then Prabhupada says, Avishnama Mukodgiranam Putam Harikatamritam Sharvanam Naiva Kartavyam Sarpochishtayata Apayaha. One should not hear from Avaishnava. Now, we all know very well one shouldn't hear from a Mayavadi and all that. But even while hearing from Vaishnava, Prabhupada says, why sometimes we hear, still we don't feel attraction for Krishna? What is the reason? He's asking the question. And then Prabhupada says that the quality of sound that you hear matters the most. There are three types of sound. Mundane sound, and second is that apparently transcendental sound, and then transcendental sound. Three things he says. So the mundane sound is emanated by materialists. Then apparently transcendental sound is emanated by many so-called religionists and pious fellows, kathakas and all these people whose goal is not to liberate you, whose goal is to pamper you and keep you in this world. That is apparently transcendental sound. They actually prepare the lectures to pamper the audience. There is no goal of purifying the heart or transforming the heart. So then both the speaker and hearer can clap hands and go, but nobody gets liberated. And the third sound is transcendental sound. The Hare Krishna says the transcendental sound is actually sound emanated by a pure devotee. Or, like we are not pure devotees, we are all progressing devotees now. We can hear from a pure devotee and repeat. Therefore, we should hear from Srila Prabhupada faithfully in his lectures and everything, and hear the recordings. Now, fortunately, this has come nowadays, what do you call it? This one device has come. You know that? Any number of that lecture of Prabhupada you put, you immediately get. So, I personally started hearing Prabhupada 3-4 lectures every day. Probably for the last 10 years or so. 18 years I must be hearing. So morning I get up, I hear, and afternoon, evening, whenever I take prasad, I keep hearing. When you keep hearing as we keep hearing regularly the lectures, then over a period of time, you see that his lectures, his purports, his conversations, his letters, there is some kind of resemblance in all this you will see. Because Prabhupada speaks the same pure things. So, and then what we take in, we give out. Gigo principle. Good in, good out. Garbage in, garbage out. But now people have no time to read Prabhupada books, hear Prabhupada lectures, but they have more time to read WhatsApp messages. So many times people, even in Bhagavatam, they say, yesterday I got a WhatsApp message, and then they say, so His Holiness Jayadutt Swami used to say, where is that from? Is it WhatsApp Purana? Then you would ask. Of course, in WhatsApp you can get a spiritual message also. It's quite possible. Pure message also you may get from somebody. I don't deny that. But the point is, many people are talking, like I was seeing recently, one devotee collects a lot of WhatsApp messages and sends me if it is spiritual. So that fellow sent me, you know, Uddhava and Krishna talking, dialogue. Then I asked him, where is it from? So then I came to know, you know, Uddhava is asking Krishna that, you know, why you didn't stop the Pandavas from playing this dice game and all that kind of dialogue. I asked, where is this from? This dialogue is from the fertile brain of one speculator who has released it from his 200 gram of grey matter. And somebody, and this fellow is, you know, sending it to me because it's a little interesting to read. I said, hell with it. I have no time for this. Now our life is so busy. First, let us put our time in taking in the pure message. And if you read such message and you tell in the lecture as if it is authentic, we'll be cheating so many people. So therefore, anybody tells you anything, catch them and ask them, what is the source? That even when I speak also, many times I take a reference from Prabhupada books and everything. So if somebody catches me, I will immediately show the reference. And you are saved immediately. So we should speak pure message and we should receive pure message. So then Prabhupada says, if we are receiving pure message, the result will be powerful. And I saw with my eyes, in the recent past, many devotees in Pune also, in the Brahmacharya ashram, many devotees left the ashram. Good number of devotees changed from saffron to white and they were moving out. And the main reason is the pure sound vibration is not going in. They are now taking in so many other sounds, many other sounds. Even if you are hearing from a devotee, you can't be sure that the devotee is purely speaking from Prabhupada's books many times. That you will come to know eventually because you will get diverted from Krishna. You will not go to the lotus feet of Krishna. You get diverted to so many other things. They talk a lot about this world. But actually the goal of all Bhaktivedanta purports is to actually take us back home, back to Godhead. So the forgetfulness is a disease of the conditioned soul and that has to be destroyed. And how to destroy it? In this verse he says, Sa uttama shloka mahanmukachyuto bhavatpadam bhoja sudha kananilaha smritim punar vismita tattva vartmanam kuyoginam no vitarattalam varehi. He is telling that smritim punaha smritim. He is saying the smriti which was lost is re-established. That means the forgetfulness is destroyed. Prema bhakti yaha hoite avidya vinashajate. And how does it happen? He says one should hear the uttama shloka, the choice poetry emanating from the lips of a pure devotee, which is carried by the wind of the Vedas. The Vedas are Vedic sound is considered as the wind, anilaha. And one should drink that honey through the ears. Now generally honey is drunk through the tongue, whereas this nectar is taken through the ears. Karoti karana ramyani manojnani chana prabho, he says. Karana ramyani means it's very relishable to the ears also and to the heart also. Krishna katha. So one should hear it in the line of disciplic line. And so our path is called Shruta Ikshita. Shruta means hear. Ikshita means see. So Shruta Ikshita path means one should see by hearing. In Sanskrit there is a word called darshan which has double meaning. One meaning of darshan is to see. Another meaning of darshan is philosophy. So philosophy goes like this and darshan is done through this. So hear and see. Shruta Ikshita path. So hear pure message and then our eyes will become Shastra Chakshu. Then when we walk out in the world we will see, we heard in Prabhupada's lecture like this, and I'm seeing the world, it is true. Whatever the Acharya says is a reality. And we are getting the same. And all of us as devotees, we receive the books on the basis. We take the books nicely. And we all keep speaking to each other the same message. And we will be very, very strong in spiritual life. We will be very, very protected in spiritual life. And our remembrance will come. And that remembrance will be purifying and elevating to us. And it will take us to greater and greater heights in spiritual life, like that. You see, Sugriva became forgetful of his promise to Lord Rama. So who reminded him? Lakshman. Lakshman came with his bow and he twanged his bow standing outside the palace. When the loud sound of the bow called was heard, then all the ministers ran to Sugriva, who was lying in the bed with bloodshot eyes and drunken in liquor. They woke him up and said, "Oh king, get up. Lakshman has come." But Sugriva turned around and slept on the other side. Then Angada came and massaged his feet and said, "Uncle, please get up." Still he was not getting up. Then Hanuman came and said, "Sugriva, get up, otherwise you will be killed," he said. Suddenly he jumped up. "I'll be killed. Who is going to kill me?" He said, "Lakshman has already come." He is in a very angry mood. When Lakshman was walking towards the palace of Sugriva, many monkeys were on either side of the road. They are watching. "Hey, who is this angry fellow? His walk, his gait is so powerful, and he is so angry." So they were picking up boulders, because in case he attacks, we can also attack back. But simply when Lakshman looked at them, they dropped it and ran away. All the monkeys. So Vanaras. Then Sugriva, when he got up, he felt ashamed that I became forgetful. He, in fact, told Tara that, "You go ahead and speak to Lakshman for a while and pacify him, then I will come. Otherwise, without hearing my words, he will finish me." So then Tara went and told Lakshman. As soon as Tara came out, Lakshman put his head down. He didn't want to see her face. So she said that, see, even sometimes great sages and saints become forgetful. In the times of the yore, it has been seen, Vishwamitra and other people, they became forgetful and fell prey to Maya. But she said that, therefore, what to speak of this Vanara? He is, after all, a Vanara. Vanaras are famous for sense gratification. So he became forgetful. He was delighting with the she monkeys and drunken in liquor. Last 4 months, Chaturmas period got over. Now it's his duty to help Ram find out Sita. "Now don't worry, I will immediately call him." So she called him. Then Sugriva came with a garland in his neck. Then he picked up the garland and threw it. He thought, if Lakshman sees my garland, he'll be more angry, as if I'm a king wearing garland or whatever. So then he bowed down to Lakshman and sought forgiveness for his forgetfulness. And then he took up his duty very seriously, subsequently. So Lakshman is the Adi Guru, who has come to wake up the sleeping soul. Sugriva, who represents a conditioned soul. So the conditioned souls are woken up by the spiritual master, by his sound vibration. And that is actually the secret. Somebody says that, "Prabhuji, I am feeling very weak in spiritual life." Why? Because Kaviraj Goswami says, you know, hearing lectures and contemplating on them, remembering them, repeating them, relishing them, this is actually like eating grains and digesting. Sometimes you find a person, he has a plate full of prasad, but even after eating that food, he still is very skinny. You have seen such people? Because as soon as he puts the food, it goes down. For some people, it's like that. That means it doesn't assimilate in the body. Then he has to go to an Ayurvedic doctor and find out what is the problem in the body, that food doesn't stay in the body. He puts food and gets dysentery. Within a half an hour, 1 hour, everything goes down. So he doesn't get... Similarly, some people, they hear lectures, they have heard a lot of lectures, but their propensity for sense gratification is not gone. That remains. Why? They still remain weak in spiritual life. Because the sound vibration we heard, we have not assimilated, digested. Digestion happens by contemplation. Contemplation means one should think, what did I hear? What is the meaning of this? Where are Shastra examples for this? Where are real life examples for this? How is it relevant to my personal life? And am I living in accordance with what I am hearing? If I am not, where is the gap? How that gap can be filled? And what am I supposed to do? What action points I should take in my life in order to get rid of this? So, therefore, when we get into this type of mode of contemplation, and then there is a definite progress which comes out as remembrance. So as Kaviraj Goswami says, when you eat the grains, you become stout and strong. Similarly, one who hears the right sound vibration is very hale and healthy. He has a healthy soul. The soul is very healthy. Nowadays, there are people giving motivational talks for the mind. Yes, mind has to be healthy also. Otherwise, somebody may commit suicide. So, mind has to be healthy. Body also has to be healthy. But if you only take care of bodily health and mental health and forget the sleeping soul, then is it not a great loss? Like Jesus said, you know, what profit of the man that if he forgets his own at the cost of his own soul? See, this verse says, Devi Krishnamayi Prokta. Krishnamayi means like a sponge absorbing water. Radhanan is always absorbed in remembrance of the Lord. That's from Padma Purana. But, yeah, one more verse I'll show you. Yeah, this one. Krishnamayi Krishnayara Bhitare Bahire. यहाँ यहाँ नेत्र पड़े ताहा कृष्ण स्फुरे कृष्णमये कृष्ण यार भीतरे बाहिरे यहाँ यहाँ नेत्र पड़े ताहा कृष्ण स्फुरे सी राधारानी इज Krishnamayi, she is absorbed in Krishna always. Yaha yaha netrapade, wherever her eyes fall, there she sees Krishna, it says. Like wherever our eyes fall, we look for sense gratification, generally, in this material world. Correct, no? There the jiva always thinks, how can I squeeze out some enjoyment from everything that I look around? Even after finishing prasad, if half a bucket of gulab jamun remain, people say, how can it remain? I think you need my help in finishing it, isn't it? So, therefore, it's worthy to remember this point that this is the very nature of Srimati Radharani, that she remembered Krishna in everything that she saw. And bhitare bahire means inside and out, outside and in. If she would close the eyes, she would remember Krishna in the heart. If she would open the eyes, wherever she saw Krishna. So this is Krishna consciousness. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu you know, practically showed this. Wherever he saw, he went around, he saw Krishna everywhere. So in the Vrindavan Leela, it is said there is a place called Man Mandir. This one particular pastime can be very encouraging to all of us. Although we have so many deficiencies and defects and incapabilities, inabilities with us. In the near the Man Mandir, opposite side there is a mountain where there is a place called Morkuti. In that place there was one blind man living there, and this blind man was a great devotee of Radha and Krishna. Always he would be chanting their names, meditating on them. Once Radharani became very pleased. So this man considered himself very incapable because he's blind, he can't do much. But one day Radharani came in his dream and gave him an instruction that you draw a particular picture and I will give you idea for the same. And he said, I am a blind man, you know, and I am not an artist. How will I be able to draw any picture at all? She said, since you are very serious and sincere in your devotional service, you will be able to do by my mercy, she said. So what did she ask him to draw? Even today you will see the drawing is there. It's made of herbal powder and minerals from Vrindavan. With that he has drawn that picture. It is still available in Morkuti. We will see that. So this is based on one particular pastime. One day in Man Mandir, Srimati Radharani went on Man. Man means anger. Now some of us may say, Prabhu, I thought even we are only angry, lusty, greedy. How can Radharani also become angry? See, anything that Radharani does is for Krishna's pleasure. Like Satyabhama becomes angry. She says that you are giving a parijata to Rukmini. What about me? It appears like envy. Actually, there is no envy. She speaks like that to please Krishna. Why? Because, you know, mild nature is pleasing. Strong nature is also pleasing in a different way. Like sometimes Prabhupada gives lectures very strongly, rascals. And devotees only laugh, isn't it? So, because you know, there is some beauty in strong nature also. Is it not true? Similarly, if you are taking only mild khichdi, chava chava chava, sattvic khichdi, if somebody brings you pickles, wonderful. Along with that, khichdi becomes very attractive. So Krishna has Satyabhama, who is like pickles, and Rukmini like simple khichdi. So we have both types of personalities, one with a mild nature, one with a strong nature. Lord enjoys that. So Lord is an enjoyer of different types of rasa, you see. Similarly, Radharani, when she would go into man mood, she would be angry. Why she would become angry? For different reasons. One day Krishna comes to Radharani and told her that, I want to learn singing from you. You are a very sweet singer. Can you please teach me? So Radharani is playing Sarigama Padanesa, and she is teaching. And Krishna is singing wrongly. She taught for the second time. Then again she sang wrongly. After trying 3, 4, 5 times, Krishna says that, see, I am unable to sing, you only sing. Then Radharani understands, you have not come here to learn singing, you have come to see me singing. So she says, I will not teach you anymore, get out of here, like that. This is one of the ways she gets man. In this way, see, Radharani has another expansion called Chandravali, who is also Radharani's expansion only. And Chandravali's feeling is, you know, I belong to Krishna. She and her associates. And Radharani's feeling is, Krishna belongs to me. Both are correct. Acharyas have said, Krishna belongs to me, I belong to Krishna. Both feelings are appropriate feelings of even the soul. Soul can feel like that. So Radharani adopts these two moods in the form of Chandravali and Radharani. But they are still called leftist and rightist. Why? In order to enhance the sweetness of Krishna's pastime, they take like two groups of gopis. Now, one time, Krishna goes to Chandravali's group of gopis, their kunja, to sing, dance, and eat nice fruits and everything. So when he goes, actually while going, he is remembering Radharani in the mind. So he goes to Chandravali and says, hey Radhe, forgetfully he says. This is transcendental forgetfulness. And Chandravali is looking at him and says, hey Kamsa, she is saying. Immediately Krishna comes to remember and says, what? I look like Kamsa for you? And Chandravali says, I look like Radharani for you? And he says, sorry, you are Chandravali, I forgot. Sometimes I go to another group and call another name. Similarly, Krishna one day was sitting with Radharani, and then he told, oh Radharani, your face is so beautiful, exactly like Chandravali. Not Chandravali, Chandra. That is it. And Radharani became angry. So, see, even all of you preachers, you have to be very careful sometimes in your dealing with devotees. Sometimes if you appreciate one devotee to another, whom this devotee has problem with, then you can land up in a problem. Correct, no? I landed up in a similar problem once. I went to one particular city where I met one particular devotee, and then I met another devotee. So just now I had met the devotee and went to the other devotee and I glorified this devotee. Then I got into problem. Next 2 hours I had to hear things which I may not want to hear. So we have to be careful. So when, of course, Chandravali and Radharani are the same person divided into two, as I told you, for the sake of Leela. So Radharani goes to Man for different reasons like this. One day when she went to Man like this, she told Krishna, you get out of here, I will not see you. Then she said, I don't want to see anything bluish, she said. Then she turned to the other side. Then she saw a peacock was standing and dancing. She said, hey, this fellow is also blue. Then she turned her face to another side. And she was wearing a blue sari. Why she wears a blue sari? Because Krishna's body is bluish color. So Radharani wears a blue sari to remember Krishna. And Krishna wears pitambar, which is Radharani's color. So he can remember Radharani. So when she turned around, she saw her own blue sari and remembered Krishna. Oh, I don't want to see this. She looked at the sky. Sky was also blue. Now she's wondering where to see now. She was turning and she was wondering which direction should I see where I will not see blue. And one of the sakis came, Lalita came there running. Hey Radhe, she said, and Lalita was also wearing blue. She said, hey, go and change your color and come. So she changed the color and came. And Radharani said, today I am in no mood to see this fellow. Then Lalita and Vishakha are at the entrance. So they told Krishna, now you have no place here, get out of here. He said, I want to learn music. He said, no music today, get out. Then Krishna went to Purnamasi. See, Purnamasi is a disciple of Narada Muni and mother of Sandipani Muni. Purnamasi. Very, very advanced, mature devotee lady who arranges, you know, who knows. Actually, she is the one who gives knowledge of Krishna to all the gopis and all. Many, you will read about her many places. So Purnamasi told Krishna, if you really want a solution to this problem, you should go to Vrindadevi. Vrindadevi knows the heart of all the devotees in Vrindavan, and she is a service awarder. Go and check with her what is to be done. So when he asked Vrindadevi, Vrindadevi said, see, every time repetitively you go, you are going to be rejected. So, but you should follow what I tell you. He agreed. So she told him that, you know, if she sees your curly locks of hair, therefore she becomes angry. So you have a shaven head, she said. No? And if she sees your flute, again she becomes angry because with your flute you attract everybody and then you are a trickster, you trick people. So then he give it up. Then he said, what to do? Take a danda, she said. No? And she said, your bodily complexion is bluish, which Radharani right now wants to reject. So better you accept a golden complexion, she said. And she said, don't wear this pitambar. Everybody knows the pitambar wearing person is who? Vishnu or Krishna only. So don't wear pitambar. Instead, change its color. You wear saffron dress. Like that, she said. And don't stand in this threefold bending form. Anybody who sees, they know it's only you. Shamam Tribanga Lalitam. Stand erect. Then immediately Krishna stood erect. Of course, Krishna doesn't have to go for shaving his hair. When he wanted to accept shavanet, he immediately transformed himself into that form. And then she said, still all these things is not enough. I will teach you a song. And you go and sing that song and go in Vraja taking a Bhiksha Patra. Then you may attract the mercy of Srimati Radharani, he said. Yeah. So then she taught a song to him. I am Sri Krishna, enchanted by Radha, having become a beggar, begging for her love. Like that she taught a song. Of course, she taught in Sanskrit, I have made in English. So this bhikshuk, this sannyasi carrying a bhiksha patra, he went in Vrindavan. So Lalita Vishaka heard this song. I am Sri Krishna. Then they said, he is not Sri Krishna. He is a sannyasi, they thought. Enchanted by Radha, he said. Yes, it is true, Krishna is enchanted by Radha. Having become a beggar. Oh, he has become a beggar or what? Begging for her love. So they heard it. Then they told Radharani, here is a beggar, but very charming beggar. He has a very effulgent face. And he is singing a very beautiful poetry. See, Radharani's problem is what? She wants to drive away Krishna, but after Krishna goes, she will call her friends and ask, where did he go? Has he gone away? Or still he is begging to meet me or not? So, and this is an experience you will get in this world also. Many times, when husband and wife have a quarrel, wife will run away to parents' home, generally speaking. And husband realizes, you know, cooking alone is so difficult. After 1 or 2 weeks, he will make a phone call to parents of the wife, you know. Please send her back. And they will say, no, you have to come and pick her up and go. So then when he goes to meet, then they will ask, we heard you are slapping her, you are beating her. We are afraid to send her. Then he will promise them, no, I promise you. You don't know how I am suffering. You know, myself. So my spiritual master was once telling, many times in a family, we become so angry, you want to be separated. When you separate, you want to be united again. When you are united, you want to be separated. this continues. Similarly, father and son, many times son doesn't listen to father. Father says, get lost, do whatever you want. And son says, okay. Then he calls him, come here, I want to tell you something. Any of your experience of this? Yeah. So, this is the way the love is. The meaning of love is what? There is every chance for the relationship to break, but it does not break. That's the definition of love Rupa Goswami has given. So, Radharani asked, hey gopis, this fellow has actually gone away. That means he doesn't want me or what? Not interested. So, they said, one beggar is singing and he is using the word Krishna. He is saying, using the word Radha. So, he is very familiar. Seems that he has been a knower of Krishna, let us call him. Maybe he is a Jyotish. So then the Jyotish, he was called there. And then they told, hey, can you, do you know hand reading? You read the hand of Radharani and tell us, when will she get Krishna? So as soon as Radharani showed the hand, he said, you know, for some people I can see the hand raised and I can find out what is what. But for some people, I get only one detail in the hand, another detail I get on the face. But Radharani had put a veil around her face. So only if I see the face of this lady, I can tell you, he said. Then Radharani lifted the veil. As soon as she lifted the veil, she saw for one moment that so-called beggar, who looked like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Next moment, he turned into Shyamsundar. So Radharani had a good laughter. Oh ho, you are the hand seer? Shyamsundar has come. So, in this way, you understand why Krishna became Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Because it was Vindadevi's order to him that unless you become a beggar like Chaitanya and you cry tears, then only Radharani will accept you. So there are many reasons said why Krishna becomes Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. One of them is this. So you will see many pastimes like this, but which teach one very important lesson. Once a devotee's heart becomes completely pure, then Krishna becomes a slave of that pure devotion. You will find Madanandapuri sitting and chanting in Govindakund, but Krishna is coming with a milk pot to come and give him. See, Krishna has no other business other than serving his devotees and hanging around with devotees and delighting in pastimes with devotees. Otherwise, there is no other work in spiritual world to do. In spiritual world, it's filled with devotees who are sakam vijaru kritapunya punjaha. The covered boys are all, you know, kritapunya punja means heaps and heaps of bhakti sukriti they have accumulated. Krishna becomes their servant. Krishna, actually, therefore Prabhupada says the gopis are on an equal level with Krishna, Prabhupada says. They are like a friend of Krishna. Because Krishna is supremely pure, the devotees are also supremely pure. So it's a relationship between pure and pure. And the only commodity exchanged is love. There is no other commodity. In the material world, people go to God for so many things. Material commodities. So therefore, these type of pastimes may be bewildering to us, may be agitating our mind. It may appear like boy-girl exchange. Why? Because our mind and heart are still tinged with avidya, ignorance. That ignorance has to be destroyed. The chanting of the holy name we do every day in order to remove that covering over the soul. Just like the cloud is preventing us to see the sun, similarly the avidya or ignorance covering over the soul is not allowing us to relish these pastimes. But in the Krishna book beginning, Prabhupada says these pastimes can be heard by three people. Bubukshu, Mumukshu, Jivan Mukta, all of them. Even a sanskrit fires, when they hear these pastimes, gradually their heart will get purified. Because this love of Radha and Krishna is supremely pure. There is not even a trace of lust in it. How do you know it? Kubja had a lust in her heart. Kama praya, it is said. Whereas the gopis are only prema. That distinguishes between the two. Because Krishna left Vrindavan at the age of 11. To Mathura, and the gopis saw him when he was 125 years old in Kurukshetra, Radha Krishna Milan Mandir. That's where they met in the eclipse time. So how many years? Subtract 125, from 125 subtract 11, how much? 114 years the gopis did not see Krishna, but the devotion to Krishna did not wane. It did not diminish. In this world, boy, girl, they love each other. But suddenly, due to some reason, you know, they could not get married. Then a boy marries another girl and goes away, girl marries another boy and goes away. The love is not so deep. You will see that here you find in the devotion of Vrijabhasis for Krishna, 114 years that love did not diminish even a bit. That is the meaning of spiritual love. And in spiritual love, there is no selfishness. There is selflessness. And this love flows outward, with the desire to serve, with no anticipation in return, no reward in return, and it is unmotivated, uninterrupted for all time to come. Even if you don't see the beloved, no problem, I just want to serve the beloved, even from being in the background. So gopis used to cook every day and wait all day for Krishna. Night they would loudly cry and go to bed. The next day morning they would come to meet Yashoda, offer obeisances, cook again. Day after day they were waiting, because Krishna had told them, I'm going to come back. So they were waiting day after day, month after month, year after year. So celebrating Radhashtami means actually we should pray that please give us the remembrance. Let we hear the pure message and let our remembrance of being Krishnadas, Krishnadasi, let that be awakened in our heart. And let us say goodbye to sense gratification. Let us become engaged in Lord's service wholeheartedly. Whether you are a grihastha, you are a brahmachari, sannyasi, vanaprastha, Krishna will only see the quality of our hearts. And once our quality is proper, then Krishna is pleased. Then Krishna will be running after you. Now we are running after Krishna. Once Krishna sees a bit of Radharani's, Radharani has ocean of love, we can have a drop of love. If Krishna sees a drop of love, then he will be behind the devotee, running. Krishna Bhagavan ki, Mantrat Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki. I'll complete the Morkuti pastime. So Radharani in the Man Mandir, after this anger, what happened, do you know? Radharani was, I took it to another the pastime. On this particular occasion, what happened? Krishna pleased Radharani in a different way. The one which I told you, the pastime of how he became Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, I got into that pastime. There's another pastime when Radharani went to Man, Krishna was not accepted. Then Krishna got down the mountain from Man Mandir and climbed up the next mountain, opposite side. There he decorated himself like a beautiful peacock with thousands of feathers. And then he started dancing very beautifully. Then the gopis happened to see, oh, who is that such a beautiful, huge peacock? Then they found that Krishna only has become peacock. Then the gopis started chatting amongst themselves. They were saying, hey, look at that peacock, how beautifully he is dancing. Krishna is dancing as a peacock. Now Radharani was in two minds. Should I see there or not? If I see Krishna, then Krishna will say, hey, your man is finished. Now you are looking at me. And if I don't see, I will miss something very important. Because today Krishna is in a special veshbhush. He is like a peacock. He is dancing very nicely. So she was in two minds. At last she could not resist herself. So she saw Krishna dancing like a peacock. Immediately she became so pleased. She also went with her friends to that mountain and decorated herself like a peahen. And then peacock and peahen together, they danced very beautifully. And that place called Morkuti. And then Radharani told this blind painter, blind person, that you paint that picture. So that painting is still there in Vrindavan. He painted it. This fellow collected some herbs and some minerals from the mountains and made a paint himself and took a canvas and did a painting as guided by Radharani. So this pastime shows that even if somebody is incapable, by Radharani's mercy, one can do something extraordinary. That is a lesson. That is Radha Kripa. By Radha Dasyam. By accepting servitorship to Radharani and faithfully, humbly serving, we can attract her attention and offer our devotion to Krishna through her to Krishna. So I completed the first time, okay? Shri Prabhupada ki. Thank you very much.